that are here, whether you be in person or online. But we also want to give you the announcements to close out our year. Amen. As Sister Hazel Winfield comes forward. Amen.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
I bring you greetings from the Fountain of Faith Baptist Church, located at 7887 Beechnut Street, Houston, Texas, 77074. We're located in the chapel of the University Baptist Church. Our pastor teacher is Reverend Mark A. King. You're invited to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, or YouTube. You can also visit us on our website at www.fofbc.houston.org. Prayer meeting and Bible study continues to be held every Wednesday at 7 p.m. via Zoom. However, on December 29th, Bible study and prayer meeting will be canceled. All scheduled meetings continues to be held via Zoom. Special announcement, New Year's Eve service will be held Friday, December the 31st via Zoom, starting at 11 p.m. till 12:10 a.m. January announcements, are due today to the Secretary of Staff via email or text. Our pastor's sermon for today is, Behold the Lamb, worthy to be praised. Found Luke 2nd chapter, verses 25 to 38. A spiritual thought for today is, as believers in Jesus, when we lose our way, God can guide us by the Holy Spirit. And by directing us in the scriptures, may God transform our hearts and minds and as we read the Bible, study it, and follow its wisdom. And now it is with great pleasure that I present to you our pastor teacher, Reverend Mark A. King. Have a blessed rest of your day.
Amen. 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 We're here to celebrate Jesus not just on the Christmas season, but every day of the year. Yes. Because we want to give him our life, our love. We want to give him our very all. And as we venture into our lesson today, actually, if you were here at Sunday school just last Sunday, you would have gotten a peek into this morning's lesson. This is just re-emphasizing how important this Christ child is, how important he was when he came in the day in which he came. And so today we have as a lesson topic, if you repeat after me, please, Behold the Lamb.
Behold the Lamb.
Worthy to be praised.
Worthy to be praised.
Behold the Lamb, worthy to be praised. This is a very familiar story dealing with Simeon and Anna, priest and priestess that were in the temple waiting for the coming of the great Messiah, our Lord and God, Jesus Christ. And this was a promise that God made true, a promise that God performed. And all Simeon had to do was continue to wait on God and believe in his word. And so we all have our handouts here. This is one thing we can do is read together. Our memory verse for today is taken from Luke, the second chapter, verses 25 and 26. Let us all read together. And there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, looking for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord Christ. Amen. May God have a blessing to the hearers and the doers of his holy word. And so what are we looking at this for? Because this is after our Lord has been born, a babe in the manger, some 40 days later. 8 days he had been circumcised, as was the Jewish law. And now some 40 days later, we're looking at the life of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ before he began his ministry. But of course, today is the day after Christmas. How about that? You know, Christmas in itself is a challenge to Christians. You know, a lot of Christians have failed the test this morning, today. Christmas Day on Saturday is a test for Christians to remember what Christmas is all about. Christmas Day on Sunday in 2022 is going to be another test for Christians to remember what Christmas is all about. But today is the day after Christmas. The presents have been given and they've been received. The meals have been eaten and the festivities have, for the most part, have ended for the year. I know some are looking forward to New Year's Eve. But in terms of the season, is gone. A lot of people are throwing out the Christmas spirit with the Christmas tree, bless their heart, because they're caught up in the commercialism, the secularism of Christmas, and not the spirit and the purpose of Christmas. You know, the tree and the decorations will come down, and Christmas will be gone for them for another year. Or will it? Or will it be gone? Will it be gone for you? Will it be gone for me? That's a good question. Christmas can go on actually for 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. That's what God expects, because Christmas is not a holiday. Christmas is a state of mind. You know, we love that Billy Joel song, a New York state of mind. God wants Christians to have a Christian state of mind. Well, what is a Christian state of mind? We just studied it this morning in the Sunday school lesson, and the title was A Humble Lord is Born. He humbled himself to go come from heaven to earth, that we might be rescued from our sin, but also to live a life some 33 years to help us understand what humility really is. Humility is to think of others before you think about yourself. And God is saying he thought about us before he thought about his position to be maintained there in heaven. He wasn't willing to grasp it, to hold on to it so tight that he could not save us while we were drowning. And the humility also means power under control. It doesn't mean that the person is so humble and giving that you can just walk all over them. I want you to understand that that's some different words, different meanings for the word humility. Somebody sent this to me a while back. And it has to do with the H factor. The H factor is called humility. When we look at these things, it deals with your motive for being humble. See, when pride hides to avoid guilt and conviction, humility, the H factor, stays in the background because of its concern for the joys and the pains of others. See, that's genuine humility. With these differing motives in view, see if you recognize some of the following tactics or strategies of the H factor or humility. Here's one. There's something called leading humility. Leading humility. All leadership should remember this. While known for producing followers, the H factor or humility can also produce leaders. Caring about the needs of others can be a strong motivation for taking the risk of leadership. See, when you take on leadership, you're taking on a risk too, because people are not going to appreciate what you're trying to do for them. People are not going to appreciate that it's about everybody and not just about you. And you're going to do what it takes to see the task through. So there's a thing called leading humility. There's also, opposite of that, one called hating humility. What is that? Hating humility. Well, by having a reputation for genuine love, humility also knows how to hate anything that threatens the well-being of others. That's why God tells us to seek out any kind of heresy in the church. You see, there's a hating humility. That doesn't mean because you're so humble you let evil have its way. That's what it means. That's a hating humility that says, I'm still humble. I'm still power under control, but I'm not going to let you just walk all over me and trample my Lord's name. I'm not going to let you infect the rest of the congregation with this false teaching. And there's something called speaking humility. I'm not going to go through all of them. There's a number of them. Speaking humility, sometimes seen as shy. Humility will speak up quickly and loudly, even at its own expense, when it seems that the interests of others are at stake. So it's talking to those people that say that they're introverts. You know, I don't like to say much, but when you see something's wrong, that's when you need to speak up. You see, silence, have you ever heard this before? Is compliance. Have you ever heard that before? We need to share this speaking humility with Congress, with the House, and with the Senate, and with the President, and those in leadership positions, with the church that have gone into a closet. speaking humility. Let me read that again. Sometimes seen as shy, don't want to hurt nobody's feelings, humility will speak up quickly and loudly, even at its own expense, when it sees the interests of others at stake. See, that's when God brings you to the crossroads of circumstances and character. You got to make a decision. Then there's what's called defending humility. Defending humility, often known for turning the other cheek. Oh yeah, turning the other cheek in response to insults. Humility can use physical force against an enemy if the situation calls for personal or national defense. That's what our military men and women do for us. There's the harm, but it means that we're gonna lose our nation, but somebody's gotta fight. If freedom is not free, did you realize that? Freedom is not free. Same thing in the spiritual life. You can't just go along with the flow. We are called Christian soldiers. That's why you need to gird up. And this is the last one I'm gonna share with you today. No, I'm gonna do one more after this because I don't wanna end on a positive note. There's receiving humility, receiving humility. This is the year of giving gifts and receiving, the season that we're in. Receiving humility is known for giving sacrificially to meet the needs of others. Humility also knows when to gratefully receive help and kindness. See, a lot of people, they won't be healed because they're not willing to receive the help that they need. You know, they have all of these wounds, and they're cutting people, bleeding all over people that never cut them. But you got to be willing to receive help if you want to be healed, if you want to get well. Finally, I'm going to end with the positive one that talks about laughing humility. So many of us have forgotten how to laugh. We've been caught up by the cares of the world. We've been overburdened. We've been consumed by our cares. And there's laughing humility. While humility knows when to cry, it spends a good deal of its time laughing with the joys of others and enjoying the favor of God. So when we talk about humility, and when our life came, you know our Lord, he laughed when he came. He took care of people. He is our example. And so I don't want us to forget about what Christmas is really about. Christmas is about the Lord who came to rescue us from ourselves, but also to be an example of how to live a heavenly life on this earth that is consumed by evil. So God is telling us here, this Christmas season can go on throughout the year, we allow Jesus to be the central figure of Christmas. And in our text, we're going to see something very important here. The Lamb of God has been born. God has stepped out of eternity and entered human history. And the Lamb was promised, as you know, and he was also prepared. And now he has been provided. He's on earth now. Our text takes us to Jerusalem for an event that occurred 40 days after the very first Christmas. And when Jesus was only 8 days old, he was circumcised as prescribed by the law in Leviticus 12:3. After 40 days, which is where we are now, Mary had reached the end of her purification. And in these verses, as we look into them, we are allowed to go to the Lord's house, that is the temple, with Jesus and his family, as they take him to be presented to the Lord and redeemed also according to the law. This is the baby dedication. This is to give the baby back to the Lord. And I hope we all have done that with our children. As you come to know Christ, you turn them over to the Lord. Now, while Joseph and Mary were there, a special event occurred. The two old saints of God that you see on your hand out there, one Simeon and the other Anna, were in that temple. They were there because the Holy Spirit had led them there. They were part of a faithful Jewish remnant, thank God for the remnant, that was looking for the appearing of the Messiah. And when they met Jesus that day, even though he was just a 40-day-old infant, just 40 days old, they were overjoyed and began to lift up in praises to the Lord. And that's what I want to see, want you to see today, to reveal to you today, the motive they had for that and the method they had for the Lamb's praise. And from that, the ministry of the Lamb's praise. We need to find out today why we are praising Jesus. You can praise Jesus even after Christmas Day. And so we get to our first outline, and we're in Luke, the second chapter. We won't read all the verses, but we'll read a few just to give you an idea of what God is trying to convey to us through the life of Simeon and Anna. And here we see the motive for their prayer and for their praise as the Lamb comes into the temple. Beginning in verse 25, it says, God is telling us in Luke, the second chapter, Luke the second chapter, verse 25. Okay. Verse 25, it says, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout. Underline the words righteous and devout. He was righteous and devout, looking for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon them. You say, even in the Old Testament? Well, in the Old Testament, it was called endowment. And when there was a temporary filling of the Spirit for the assignment and the work that God had for people to do. Verse 26, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord Christ. Verse 27, and he came in the Spirit, he was walking in the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought the child, Jesus, to carry out for him the custom of the law, then he took him in his arms and he blessed God and said, 29, now, Lord, you are releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. God always keeps his word. And finally, I'll stop at verse 30. It says, for my eyes have seen your salvation. My eyes have seen your salvation. So what is taking place here? What is the motive for his praise? A lot of people praise God, but we wonder if they have the right motivation. Is it all just show? Is it all just performance? Or can they really relate to blessing that God has in place upon their lives? You know, faith always follows faith. And God wants whatever we do to do it from the source of faith. When Simeon enters the temple and takes Jesus into his arms, the old man declares, for all to hear, he's not ashamed at all, the reasons for his joy. Does anybody know the reason of your joy? Does anybody know the source of your joy? The question is, do you have any joy? Or have you lost the joy of your salvation? Because Christmas is over with and you're about to throw out the Christmas tree, or you're going to throw out the Christmas spirit as well. Well, if not, let's stay in the Christmas state of mind right now. So in his speech, Simeon gives us a threefold motive for praising the Lord that is just as valid today as it was then. A threefold motive, if you will. And that motive was he's praising God because of who had appeared. He knows who Christ is. He knows who this child is. He's praising God because of why he has arrived. Do you know why Jesus came? Do you know Christmas was a rescue mission? Do you know he came to save your very soul, to redeem you from the slave market of sin? So he praised God because of who he is, the Son of God. And he praised God because of why he came. He's our Redeemer. And he praised God because of what he would accomplish. He would accomplish something for us that we could not accomplish for ourselves. So when you look at that, I want you to think about what is occurring here. Just look at the man's name. The man's name is Simeon. Underline the word Simeon. The word Simeon means he who hears. He who hears. When the last time you heard from God? Do you know how to hear from God? Dr. Charles Stanley has an awesome book out, a little small paper book called How to Listen to God. Well, I saw that, I immediately bought that book. How to Listen to God. And when you hear the preacher preach all the time, you know he's got a special relationship with the Lord. It's so simple and profound that each and every message of his is. It's so honest and it's so revealing that you know he's got a close walk with the Lord. And it's interesting that he makes it sound so tangible when he tells you that he got a word from the Lord. You can just almost picture the Lord just whispering in his ear. But when you walk close with the Lord, and you are that sensitive to his spirit. And so here we see the word Simeon. And when the Lord told him to wait, he would not die until he saw the Christ child. He heard and he believed. Now it's one thing to hear, it's another thing to believe. It's one thing to hear, it's another thing to believe and be obedient to God's will and God's way. So God's not always going to talk to you. He's not going to talk to you in an audible voice. He's going to talk to you in a still, quiet voice by means of the Holy Spirit putting a thought in your mind. And that thought is supposed to coincide with God's word. It's going to agree with God's word. Question is, will you be obedient to what you heard? And apparently this man had been hearing the voice of the Holy Spirit for some time, according to verse 26, because he said that he walked with the Lord. So then he took him up into his arms, and he says, and then he had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit, verse 26, that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord Christ. The Holy Spirit had whispered in his ear and told him God's command. He had been told that he would not die until he saw the Jewish Messiah and the Savior of the world. How? For himself. For himself. So when old Simeon sees Jesus, he is notified by the Spirit, this is the Christ. When Joseph and Mary walked into the temple and Simeon was there to do his praise, his normal praise, and he saw the Christ child, he knew exactly who he was. And that was the same way when our Lord walked this earth. You know, the people that were searching for the truth, that were living by the truth, they recognized who he was immediately when he spoke and how he carried himself and how consistent he was in following our Father's will and his way. So Simeon begins to praise the Lord because of who had entered the temple, who had entered the world, the only Savior of our soul. So the promised Messiah, the promised prophet, the promised priest, the promised king had arrived, even 40 days old. So he is identified here. Who is this person that entered the temple? The Lord's Christ. Underline that phrase. The Lord's Christ. The Lord's salvation. The appointed one, the anointed one, had made his way into the temple to follow. For Simeon says in verse 30, for my eyes have seen your salvation, your deliverer, Lord. You said I wouldn't leave this earth until I saw it. Simeon understood and who he was, but few others did. That's how you can come to church and miss God. A lot of people were in the temple that day. Everybody know who Christ was because they wouldn't focus on his word. They weren't in tune with his spirit. Question needs to be asked today, the day after Christmas. How many people are still in tune with God's spirit? Still understand his truth, or just waiting for another event to take place? Worship is not an event, worship is a lifestyle. Worship is not an event, worship is a lifestyle. Simeon understands that. That's why he had the privilege of seeing the Christ. 8 days earlier, on the night Jesus was born, 8 days earlier on that night when Jesus was born, some humble shepherds, you may recall, had come to worship him after that had taken place. And some heavenly angels, when he was born, were in the sky, marauding, going across the sky as a military review, saying, praise to God in the highest. But sadly, many others didn't know who he was. We're talking about who entered the temple. We're talking about his motive for giving God praise, worshiping God in praise. He had a praise on the inside that he couldn't keep to himself, that welled itself all the way up outside of his mouth. Verse 30 and 32 says, he praises God because of why he arrived. One thing to know who he is, the angels know, the fallen angels, the demons know who Christ is. But then, can you appreciate why he exists? Or can you appreciate why he arrived? Simeon understands that he's the Lord's Christ. He's the salvation of the world. So as Simeon praises God the Father for the baby Jesus, he tells us a little bit about why Jesus came into the world. We are told in verse 30 again that Jesus is salvation. Jesus is, you need salvation after Christmas Day. You need salvation if you're not saved right now. And if you are saved, you need to be delivered from trying to give your life more emphasis than the life of Christ. So God is saying, you need to understand why he came. And so the ministry that this baby will fulfill will impact the Jewish nation. It will actually impact the entire world. Not only will he reach the Jews, he'll reach out to the Gentiles as well. That includes you and me. A Gentile is a non-Jew. And basically, Simeon is reminding us that Jesus came into this world to save all those who will come to him by faith. Faith alone in Christ alone will give you salvation. Faith alone in Christ alone, by grace alone. You cannot merit it. You cannot inherit it. All you can do is accept, receive what Jesus Christ is offering, his indescribable gift the Father is giving us. Whether a person is a Jew or Gentile, Jesus came to provide salvation to all who will receive him, and that is a promise of the Word of God and that great love letter of John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Everlasting life. You see, you got limited life now, but God wants to give you everlasting life. He also wants to give you what's called eternal life. See, people think eternal life is just about duration, but it's also about quality of life. He wants you to enjoy the quality of your life. And so this is what Simeon understood, and this is why he praised God, because of why he had arrived. And finally, his third motive was that he praised God, this Lord Christ, because of what he would accomplish. What he would accomplish. And Jesus not only came, but he stayed in the Father's plan. From his first cry in Bethlehem's manger to his last cry on Calvary's cross, he gave us the gift of his undying love. He not only died, but he rose again 3 days later. And then after that, 40 days he walked this earth and then ascended to heaven, opening the door for you and I to join him. If you accept his person as the Son of God, you accept his work as Redeemer, delivered on the cross of Calvary for your sins and mine. So that last phrase in 34 and 35, he praises him because of what he would accomplish. Well, let's look at 34 and 35. He says, and Simeon blessed him, the child, the Christ child. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, he blessed the child and he blessed the parents as well and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and the rise of many in Israel and for a sign to be opposed. It's not only a good thing that he's come, that's comfort, but there's all going to be conflict. Comfort and conflict are going to intersect because of this child. 35, it says, and a sword will pierce even your own soul to the end that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. He said, Mary, you're a blessed woman, but you're going to be stricken in your heart to see your child down that cross because your son is also your Savior. And so when we look at why he's praising him because of what this child is going to accomplish, it's an awesome revelation. Simeon continues to praise my offering of prophecy that I just shared with you with what Jesus would accomplish in his life. And it's in these very verses that we look at here. The old man speaks of a storm. He speaks of a sign and he speaks of a sword. Look at that verse again. He speaks of a stone. He speaks of a sign and he speaks of a sword. The phrase that he says, a fall and rising again of many in Israel. You know, Christmas has tripped up a whole lot of people in 2021. Christians have forgot what Christmas is all about. They enjoying their gifts, they're opening more gifts right now, ain't getting price of thought. Ain't thought about it one bit. But they are enjoying everything that he has provided because he is the source of every resource. There are some Christians that haven't gone to the table to thank God for watching over them, not 1 month, 2 months, but 12 months throughout this pandemic year. So it says, he shall be a fall and rising of many in Israel. I believe Psalm 33:12 says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. You can call yourself a patriot all you want to, but if you're not sharing Jesus Christ, you're an enemy of the state. Yes. You are an enemy of Christ Jesus. Most patriotic thing you can do is share the gospel. I like how Charles Spurgeon said it, Christian. He said, either you are a missionary or an imposter. Either you are a missionary or an imposter. When was the last time you shared Christ with somebody? When is the last time you shared Jesus Christ with someone? And so he talks about him being the fall and the rise of many in Israel. And this refers to Jesus as the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy. You'll see that in Psalm 118:22 as well as Isaiah 8 and 14. Because many in Israel would stumble over the life and the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. They would stumble in rejection and conviction, but a few would rise in salvation. You see, the Holy Spirit came to convict people of righteousness and judgment, you know, and many would still stumble over that. But a few, thank God, it's always a few, it's always a remnant. So don't get excited, church, because there's not as many people here that should be here, because there's always going to be only a few. But you have to lead the way. You're the avant-garde. You're the ones that are leading the way so that when people get bogged down and they want to give up because they want to halt because of life. When I say halt because of life, when they become hungry, when they become angry, when they become lonely, when they become tired, they want to give up. Be careful. That's an acronym, HALT, H-A-L-T. When you become hungry, when you become angry, when you become lonely, when you become tired, that's when Satan will pounce on you and say, what is your faith worth? Look at where you are now. Look at where you are now. There ain't no God there. He don't care about you. You forget the promises of God. But if you're standing on the sure foundation of God's promises, you'll let him know nothing is too hard for the Lord. Yeah. I'm going to wait on Jesus. Yeah. In the process, I'm going to utilize my faith to take me to the next stage in life. So here's what God is talking about, how this baby Jesus would be a stumbling block for many people. He says that he is a stone, remember that? The stone that the builders rejected. We're talking about the religious builders. They got all these prophets, they got all these Pharisees, brother, and Sadducees, and they understand, they can quote the law, they don't understand the law. They can quote the law and they still miss Jesus. Now, if they can miss Jesus, you better believe you can miss Jesus. We're talking about theologians. We're talking about people that have been trained in seminary and then some, and they can still miss Jesus. We're talking about the stone that the builders rejected. So he reveals men for what they really are. That's what that baby's going to do. Everything in your spiritual life hinges on how you answer one question. What think ye of Christ? What think ye of Christ? Who is he to you? Why did he come? What did he accomplish? That question determines whether your soul stands in a right relationship with God. And you have got to give the answer. And so he is also said to be a sign. Underline the word sign. That means miracle. Jesus Christ is God's miracle. But instead of receiving him as a gift and revelation of God, his enemies attack him and crucify him. Now if they attack and crucify Jesus, they're going to do the same to you. It won't be to the extent that it was done during the Roman time, but don't expect everybody to like you because you got good news. But you share the truth in love still. Share the truth in love and let God continue to protect and provide for you. Jesus Christ is a miracle. Guess what? You're a miracle too. How God can take a sin-sick soul like you and I and also bless us with his righteousness and give us his salvation. We are walking miracles. But remember why we're here. We are created in Christ Jesus for good works. We still got work to do. And so our Lord said he sent a sign. He sent God's miracle. But instead of receiving the gift, or we'll receive any other gift but the right gift. But instead of receiving him as a gift and revelation of God, his enemies attacked and crucified him. His birth was a miracle. And they attacked that. Over in John 8:41, they talk about he couldn't be God. His miracles were ridiculed, being attributed to the work of Satan. And they lied about his character. They put his character in question. They mocked him as he died. And they lied about his resurrection. Oh, the list that Satan would go to in order to deny the truth, to repress the truth. You want to walk as close to the Lord as you can. And finally, he was a sword. They talked about him being a sword. Of course, this was Mary's pain, bless her heart. She would have to see a son placed on the cross and crucified in her very presence to become subject to a pain that no man can adequately describe. And every nerve ending in your body is going off on all the lungs. And your body's dehydrated. And you look like bones. And you just hanging on. She suffered as she watched Jesus fulfill the Father's plan. The ultimate hurt came the day she watched him dying on that cross for you and I, for sinners. The bottom line of this is that Jesus Christ entered this world to provide salvation for the lost. The lost was you and I. The lost are still out there needing to be rescued by somebody already that has been rescued. For this miracle man, for this chief cornerstone, we're talking about, make sure your motive's right when you say you're worshiping God. Move to our second outline, and we look at the method of the Lamb's praise. Well, there's a method to praising God. People praise God in a lot of different ways, but there's a basic method that to let it be known that you're not ashamed of the God that saved your life. Romans 1:16 says, I'm not ashamed of God. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, who by the power of God leads to salvation. Not to the Jew first, and then to the Gentile. As we move on, we see the method of this praise is vocal. It's a vocal praise. It's a visible praise, and it's a verbal praise. You know, you can't stay quiet about God if he's done something mighty in your life. I don't know how you can stay quiet if you really are saved. You know, there are three clauses for the word if in the Greek, you know, but if it is true, if it is not true, if it may be true. So if you're saved, you know, hope is the first condition. If you're really saved, how can you stay quiet about what God has done for you? And so we see there's a method to this praise. It has to be vocal. It should be visible and it should be verbal. Simeon didn't just see Jesus Christ and rejoice in his heart. Oh, I'm going to keep this in my heart. You hear a lot of people say, I'm a Christian too, but it's personal, it's private. I just keep it to myself. But I question whether or not you're really saved. Because at some point in your life, somebody should know that you are saved and you're glad about it. They should know it. I'm not saying you got to run all over the room or around the building, but it should be seen in your walk, in your talk. The best witness is a good example. So Simeon couldn't keep it to himself, so he opened his mouth and he lifted up his voice in praise of the Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't keep inside, all bottled up. J. Moss had it right. I had to praise on the inside. I can't keep to myself. It's rising up to the top. That should be something inside of all of us. The praise was also visible. Simeon, he involved his entire person in the act of his praise. You see that picture on your hand now. Look at that picture. He's giving his all there. You like to hear that song called Total Praise. That's total praise. That's a picture of total praise right there. And that spectacular graphics that you see there, that's also what's going on inside his soul. He's holding glory. He's in the midst of glory. He's in the presence of God. I don't know how you can't feel that at some point during the day, at least during the week, if you're really meeting with God on a regular basis. Simeon involved his entire person. It was visible to those that looked at it. He lifted the baby Jesus up in high praise. He wasn't embarrassed to vocally and visibly praise his Redeemer. And then when you get to verse 38, you see that it was also verbal. He didn't hold back. He said, I just can't keep it to myself. It's like fire shut up in my bones. In verse 38, you go over there and say that at that very moment, we see Anna. Even Anna gets in on the praise. You see Anna to the far right on the handout. She came up and began giving thanks to God and continued to speak of him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. It's got to be verbal. You know, after people hear you say something about it and they see you visibly moved by it, then you got to talk about why you're doing it. Even Anna enters the arena of prayer. She blends her voice with that of Simeon. But she adds an additional element. If you look at that verse in verse 38, and while Simeon has lifted his hands, his heart, and his voice to the Lord, Anna praises the Lord, but she also tells. She not only praises, she said, but let me tell you what God has done for me. Well, what does the scripture have to say about this method of the Lamb's praise? Well, over in Psalm 98:4, it says this. It says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Make a loud noise and rejoice and sing praise. We're commanded to make a joyful noise. We will not to be mumbling these gospel hymns. We are singing with every fiber of our being, because there's somebody right now on a ventilator. Somebody wishes they could get a quick breath. If I could just say, help me, I can't say it, you say it for me. If they could just say, Jesus, thank you. And we ought to be willing to say that on a daily basis. That's what the psalm says about a vocal praise. Even over in Hebrews 13:15, it says, by him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God. How often? Continually. That is, the fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. The fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. Amen. Yeah, I don't even care if you have no teeth in your mouth. Give God some gum praise. If you got a snag or two like I used to have, give God some whistle praise. Thank you, Lord. Whatever you can get out, give to the Lord. He wants it. He wants you to show that you're not ashamed to praise his holy name. So when the scripture talks about invisible praise in Psalm 63:4, it says this, thus will I bless while I live. You can't praise him while you're about to die. Praise him now when you got vigor. I'm going to turn my life over to the Lord when I turn 60, 78. No, he wants your youth, young people. Because as so many things God can show you and do with your life that you can't even imagine. He not only wants to bless you, he wants you to be a blessing to others. God doesn't want us to be a puddle of water drying in the sun. He wants us all to become a stream, a river of blessing. That's what God wants. So there has to be a visible praise. You can not only get excited about your favorite R&B artist at a concert, get excited about Jesus Christ on a daily basis. Get excited about Jesus Christ at church. So there has to be a verbal praise. And talk about it. Psalm 107, verse 2. Say, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let those rescued say so, whom he had redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Mark 5, verses 19 and 20 says this. Howbeit, Jesus suffered him not, but said unto him, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord had done for thee, and had compassion on thee. And he departed and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him, and all the men did marvel or were amazed. That's what we should be saying at this time of year, this Christmas season, going through 12 months of pandemic, peril, and danger. We can't keep it to ourselves. Finally, our last outline, we see the ministry of the Lamb's praise. The ministry of the Lamb's praise is basically found in three verses there, 28, 33, and 38. Back to verse 28, we see what God is trying to tell us about this ministry. It says, then he took him into his arms and blessed God. And he went on to say the blessings that will come from this baby. Verse 33, he says, and his father and his mother were amazed at the ministry of Jesus Christ, that the things which were being said about him. But a part of his ministry included verse 38. And it says that at that very moment, Anna had seen what was going on. She praised God like no one had ever seen before. So as the name of the Lord was praised publicly, there was something going on here. Three precious things took place that day. The sovereign was exalted, the saints were edified, and the sinners were evangelized. We need to ask ourselves in our coming and going, are we exalting our sovereign king? Or are people that say they're Christians by looking at our walk, are they edified? Or are they better because they've come into our presence? And anyway, if somebody who doesn't know Christ knows you, are they coming to know Christ because they know you? That's the question that should be answered. Well, I put it simply this way. Are we leaving people every day with a thirst for Christ? Are we leaving people every day, fountain, people with a thirst for Christ? Because we want you to be a fountain and not a drain. Yes. Be a fountain and not a drain. And so God is saying this is what should occur, because every Christian is a missionary, or they're simply an imposter, as Charles Spurgeon has said. But God says there's a mighty work that needs to be done, but you have to recognize who I am. I am your sovereign, I am your king, and I'm giving you this command to go out and share my truth, go out and share the deliverance that I offer to people. It brought glory to God when he was praised in the temple, when he saw the Christ child being praised by Simeon and Anna, and the word getting out. Everything in the temple was really about ritual during that time. See, people are big on ritual. Ritual without reality. Yeah, people go to church, but I'm going to tell you, I believe at least 40% of people go to church today are not saved. I go, and I ain't going out on a limb. That might be putting a little bit too low. 40% of the people in every church, probably not saved. Whether it be big or small, because they bought into the ritual and not the relationship. You need to know that you're saved. God is saying the only way you get to know that is you draw close to me. He said, come unto me, not to the event. Come unto me, all you that are weary and heavy laden. I give you rest. You don't have to tell me. Some of you are going to bed at night not knowing that if you die, you go to heaven or go to hell. I still talk to people today and I ask them, why should Christ, if you died today, if he asked you, why should I allow you into my heaven? Tell the truth. The first thing you're going to say is, I think I'm a pretty good person. You're going straight to hell. Because your best is that's filled with rags on the outside of God. God is saying now, it's what my son did for you, not what you can do for yourself. God is saying, by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so God is saying, your praise should exalt your king. You are citizens of heaven now. You have a new citizenship on earth and on heaven. The only one that's going to really last is your citizenship in heaven. Because this earth is temporary. This earth is temporary. And so God is saying now, you need to exalt me. And when you exalt God, that's when you see the saints will be edified. You got to write it on your hand after that. It said, Mary and Joseph heard the praises. And they were given hope and encouragement by the praises of these precious saints. Don't you know that we encourage one another when we see each other at church? Because we know we're still on the Christian journey. You're not giving up. We've all encountered different kinds of experiences. We've all encountered hurt, harm, but we still are holding on to God's precious hand. We're clinging to the hem of his garment. When you come to the end of the rope, you should see the hem of his garment. That's why every day you should hem your day in prayer. Why? Because it's less likely to become unraveled. Every day hem your day in prayer, because that way it's less likely to become unraveled. A lot of people fall apart before the day is done because they hadn't started the day with Christ Jesus. So the saints were edified, and finally the sinners were evangelized because they saw all this going on. That made them open to hear. But what's the big news? The Bible tells us that Anna went off without and told us about this baby she had seen. The Bible says she spake of him. She didn't keep it to herself. She spake of him. Think about the discussion that went on, because she was verbal in her praise. Lost sinners were there. They could find out about who Jesus was. That's what we need to consider. As I close, we're talking about the day after Christmas. And every day, we should behold the Lamb that is worthy of our praise. When Jesus was born, heaven got excited. When Jesus was born, the God-man was born, heaven got excited. Angels came down and shared the message with those poor shepherds. These men heard the praise of the angels, and they went to see for themselves. They met Jesus, and they came away what? Praise in his name. And then when Jesus was taken to the temple 40 days of age, he was greeted by the praises of two elderly saints of God, Simeon and Anna, who couldn't contain themselves. They couldn't hold it. They couldn't keep it together. They had unrestrained praise. Unrestrained praise. All through his life, Jesus was praised by those who love him. He said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. There were even two occasions when the Father spoke of his own praise out of heaven. You recall when he said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. One point he even tell one of the disciples, be quiet. Be quiet and listen to him. This is my Son, in whom I'm well pleased. I don't need you to tell me to build three temples for this person, that person. You're just here to witness it, to observe. Then you go run and tell him. Finally, we see in verse 30 here, Simeon talks about departing because he's seen the Lord's salvation. He said, Lord, I've seen it. You've allowed your promises to me to come to fruition. I'm ready to be called home if that's your will for my life, because I know my future is greater than my past. I know great things about to take place because he's the only true celebrity in this life. He is the unique person of the universe. Your Son, Jesus Christ, Redeemer, Savior, King, God, Lord, worthy to be praised. Father, we come before you once again with bowed heads and humble hearts. We thank you for the close of this Christmas season. We thank you, Father God, we haven't gotten caught up in cliches, but understand the significance of the truth of why your Son came. We praise your holy name, Father God, for selecting us even in eternity past, giving us an opportunity to finally hear a clear view of the gospel and make a choice to say, yes, Lord, to your will, yes, Lord, to your way. Father, we pray for those that are still without Jesus Christ, those that are still, Father God, on the outside looking in. We ask that your Holy Spirit reveal to them right now that your Son is the way, the truth, and the life. There's no way to the Father but through your Son, Jesus Christ. Enable them to see themselves for who they are, sinners in need of a Savior. And upon accepting his person, the Father God, and his work on the cross, we ask that you accept them, Father God, into your home, into your kingdom. Bless us, O Lord, as we move forward in your will and your way. In the sweet and strong name of Jesus, I pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your hearing. Thank you for giving God an ear.